routine. Live truth. Live Catholic.
Family, a prayer that we pray together is a powerful prayer. So please pray together with me our EWTN family prayer. Today we pray for those suffering from natural disasters. Almighty God, we humble ourselves before you, the creator of all things visible and invisible. So many throughout the world suffer from the forces of nature. Have mercy on them, O Lord. So many have died from disasters. Give them eternal rest, O Lord. Do not look on our sins, but on our faith in you. We place all of our hope in your goodness. Calm the storms, bring gentle rains to our lands, and let your people live in tranquility and peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood,
of slaves on the hand of their lords, so our eyes are on the Lord our God, till he show us his mercy. Have mercy on us, Lord, have mercy. Like the eyes of slaves on the hand of their lords, so our eyes are on the Lord our God, till he
Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with
brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, Ever-Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison.
us pray. Convert us, O God our Savior, and instruct our minds by heavenly teaching, that we may benefit from the works of Lent. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Leviticus. The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the whole assembly of the children of Israel and tell them, 'Be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. You shall not steal. You shall not lie or speak falsely to one another. You shall not swear falsely by my name, thus profaning the name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not defraud or rob your neighbor. You shall not withhold overnight the wages of your day laborer. You shall not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block in front of the blind. But you shall fear your God. I am the Lord. You shall not act dishonestly in rendering judgment. Show neither partiality to the weak, nor deference to the mighty, but judge your fellow men justly. You shall not go about spreading slander among your kin, nor shall you stand by idly when your neighbor's life is at stake. I am the Lord. You shall not bear hatred for your brother in your heart. Though you may have to reprove him, do not incur sin because of him. Take no revenge and cherish no grudge against your fellow countrymen. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord."
Verbum Domini.
Your words, Lord, are spirit and life. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The decree of the Lord is trustworthy, giving wisdom to the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The command of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eye. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true, all of them just. Let the words of my mouth and the thought of my heart find favor before you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Secundum Mateum.
Gloria tibi, Domine.
Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him. and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. A stranger and you welcomed me. Naked and you clothed me. Ill and you cared for me. In prison and you visited me." But then the righteous will answer him and say, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you?" And the king will say to them in reply, "Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these least brothers of mine, you did for me." Then he will say to those on his left, "Depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill and in prison, and you did not care for me." Then they will answer and say, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not minister to your needs?" He will answer them, "Amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me." And these will go off to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. Verbum Domini.
Laus tibi Christe.
When I used to study for exams, one of the questions I would ask myself would be, what questions am I going to get? I thought it would be useless to study something and I won't be asked for what I studied for. I know this is not an A-plus way to study. One is supposed to study to grow in knowledge and wisdom and not just to pass the test. Yet, regardless, however one studies, in the end, the exam would consist of questions to be answered. That's the bottom line. Now, similarly in life, that's how it will be in the end. There's no surprise. The major question is already given for us to get ready. The question of a lifetime is already given for us to prepare now until the moment we shall be called home. The question is, what have you done to Christ and your neighbors? What have I done to Christ and my neighbors? That's the question. That's what you and I will be asked at the end of our life. Not just you and I, but everyone alive now. Everyone who will be alive. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in His glory and all the angels with Him, He will sit upon His glorious throne and all the nations will be assembled before Him." He said, all the nations. He said, all. All meant everyone, regardless of age, of sex, of color, and religion. And that includes all of us. That includes the unbelievers, that includes people of goodwill with no specific religion, That includes anti-religion people, anti-Catholic people, anti-Christians, and even the terrorists. All, whether they worship Jesus Christ now or later, all will be assembled before him. And God will separate depending upon the answer to that question of a lifetime. The difference between preparing for exams and preparing to meet the Lord is that when we prepare for exams, we get the questions when the exams start. And we answer the question then. When we prepare to meet the Lord, we get the question already. We are answering the question now during this life by our actions to Christ who is in our neighbors. And when we meet the Lord, we get the final result of our test and know where we shall go. Now, during Lent, we are called to examine our lives. We are called to examine how have we helped our neighbors. You know, our neighbors don't need to be too far away. We don't need to go to the other side of the world. We don't need to go on a missionary work for so far of miles distance away. Our neighbors can simply be our parents. Our neighbors can simply be our children. Our neighbors can simply be our own siblings and simply be our friends, our relatives, our community, and so on. We have to start at home. True love begins at home. True love begins in our own family. Our neighbors can be our own spouse. It's good to intensify our prayers during Lent. That's what we're called for. Remember, Ash Wednesday, that's one of the things that we are called for. You know, it's good to take upon ourselves the discipline of fasting or mortification. That's what we're called last week, less than a week ago, on Ash Wednesday. But the other part of that is the almsgiving. We don't want to forget almsgiving. Let's not forget that important question we are challenged to answer here and now. What will you do for Christ and your neighbors during this Lent? What will I do to Christ and our neighbors during this Lent? How do we want our life to be at the end? And do we want to hear, "Come, inherit the kingdom prepared for you"? Or do we want to hear, "Depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels"? I think all of us don't want to hear the latter. I think all of us want to hear that welcome to enter the kingdom of God and to live eternally with exceeding joy that's beyond this earth's description. So what will we do for Christ and our neighbors during this Lent? Will we feed the hungry with food? Will we provide drinks to the thirsty? Will we welcome a stranger, clothe the naked? Will we care for those who are ill? And sometimes those who are ill may not necessarily be physically ill. They look fine and healthy, but sometimes we neglect them. Will we visit those in prison? And for some, the prison may not necessarily, you know, jail, but prison may be for some people on a hospital bed. For some, the prison may be in a nursing home. Will we visit Christ in our neighbors there? You know, with God's grace, let's do all that when the opportunity arises. With God's grace, let's answer that ultimate question about what we will do to Christ and our neighbors during this Lent. That, you know, let's answer that here and now by our own lives. With God's grace, let's not neglect Christ dwelling in our neighbors. What we can do today, let's do today. St. John Paul II said, "The future starts today and not tomorrow." Present our petitions to our Heavenly Father.
That the Holy Father and his fellow bishops and priests may be bound together in peace and love in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the Church and all its members may plunge deeper into contemplative prayer and the mystery of the incarnation of the Word, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who suffer may be filled with the peace of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family of God seeking eternal rest, that they may find light, happiness, and peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Pray for my niece, Rebecca Mary, who celebrates her birthday this day, and also for Sister Raymond from the Little Sisters of the Poor in Mobile, who is going through a rehab for her after her surgery. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray also for those who are ill in any way, those who are in despair, those who are depressed, that the Lord may grant them a greater hope in Him. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We entrust all these intentions and those within our hearts to the prayers of our Blessed Mother as we pray together. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary,
Mother of God,
pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Heavenly Father, we praise, adore, and thank you for always hearing our prayers. Grant these petitions we present before you, and we ask all these through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
this devout oblation be acceptable to you, O Lord, that by your power it may sanctify our manner of life and gain for us your conciliation and pardon through Christ our Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. Our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For through bodily fasting, you restrain our faults, raise up our minds, and bestow both virtue and its rewards through Christ our Lord. Through him the angels praise your majesty, dominions adore, and powers tremble before you. Heaven and the virtues of heaven, and the blessed seraphim, worship together with exaltation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in humble praise as we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, plenis ut celi et terra gloria tua, hosanna.
Fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
We eat this bread and drink this cup, we pray.
as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection. We offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and for my divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
A new stay. Qui tollis peccata mundi. Miserere nobis. A new stay. Qui tollis peccata mundi.
Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should come.
Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of the least of my brethren, you did it for me, says the Lord. Come, you blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world.
To those who cannot now receive Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, we offer the following prayer. Eternal Father, I offer up to Thee my intellect, that it may learn to know Thee alone. Sweetest Jesus, I offer up to Thee my memory, that it may remember Thee alone. Holy Spirit, Spirit of Charity, I offer up to Thee my will, that Thou mayest enkindle and warm it by Thy divine love. Adorn my soul with Thy seven gifts, and let me become Thy pure temple. Fill me with Thy grace, and prepare my heart to receive spiritually my God. Jesus, my God, as I am unable to receive Thee sacramentally, do Thou receive me into Thy heart, and unite me so perfectly with it that nothing may ever be able to separate me, even for a moment, from Thee. Engulf my misery and my nothingness in the abyss of Thy mercy, that I, changed into Thee, may henceforth live only for Thee, by Thee, and in Thee. Come, therefore, Thou, my only satisfaction, come to take possession of this heart, which belongs to Thee, and cannot live one moment without Thee. Amen.
Spirit, renew within me.
Cast me not out from your presence, and your Holy Spirit take not from me. Create a clean heart in me, O God. Give me back the joy of your salvation, and a willing spirit sustain in me. I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall return to you. Create a clean heart in me, O
Let us pray. We pray, O Lord, that in receiving your sacrament, we may experience help in mind and body, so that kept safe in both, we may glory in the fullness of heavenly healing. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Bow down for the blessing. Enlighten the minds of your people, Lord, we pray, with the light of your glory, that they may see what must be done and have the strength to do what is right. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
Deo gratias.
tuum sacramentum.
Father, from the moment these children were conceived, you knew their names. In the silent first hours of their lives, as cells divided and their living flesh quickened, your love breathed deep within, and they began to grow in your image and likeness. May our prayers be accompanied by choirs of angels as we await their births. We ask this through your child, who was formed in the Virgin's womb, and who lived and died for us, Lord, forever and ever. Amen.
A tabernacle is a structure in which the Blessed Sacrament is held in reserve after Mass. Tabernacles are usually locked to maintain the security of the consecrated hosts, constructed of ornate material, and should be in a place of prominence and respect in the Church.
About to speak to 8,000 young people. Down the street at the Verizon Center, they're preparing the room for 18,000 young people. And the only reason we don't have more people at these events is that they're maxed out. There's no seats left. The Diocese of Arlington put on two different events for 17,000 kids. This young generation is pro-life. You know, young people have a way of seeing past all our rhetoric when it comes to this debate. The science is undeniable. A fetus is a human life. A baby at 18 days has a heartbeat, brain waves at 42 days, all body systems present at 8 weeks, fingernails at 11 weeks, has vocal cords and can cry at 12 weeks, can feel pain at 20 weeks, and at 23 weeks, can survive if delivered instead of being aborted. The ethics of abortion, it's undeniably clear. The impact on women's become clearer and clearer over time, too. A book recently written called Complications said 650 papers, most of them are medical journals, that shows that abortion has a negative impact on almost every aspect of a woman's health, from infertility to autoimmune disease to breast cancer to mental health disorders. By the way, if that's you, check out Project Rachel, hopeafterabortion.com, because there's always hope. The medical community is clear. Abortion is never necessary to save a mother's life. But sometimes there's a procedure that has to be done that indirectly results in the death of the baby. Like my mom needs chemotherapy and it indirectly results in the death of her fetus. Or if there's an ectopic pregnancy and a part of the fallopian tube that the baby's in has to be removed. But that's not the same as an abortion. It's not the same as directly killing the child. And if it sounds like I'm splitting hairs here, you know what? It's pretty important to split hairs when it comes to a human life. But all that aside, the number of abortions performed that are even pretending to be to help the mom and save her life are astronomically small, next to the number of abortions done as a matter of convenience. Or worse, the number of abortions done because women are ill-informed and they truly feel like there's no other option. And they didn't go to a crisis pregnancy center, but found their way into a Planned Parenthood instead by accident. There's always another option. Life is always an option. And if you want your baby, someone does. In July 2013, Father Tom Vanderwood in Virginia learned of a couple that was about to abort their Down syndrome baby and they couldn't find someone to adopt. He posted it on the parish Facebook page. Got about 900 emails. Got so many phone calls that had volunteers come in and man the phones. Hundreds of people said, if you don't want your baby who even has Down syndrome, we do. life is always a choice. We forged the United States into a culture of death. A place where it's survival of the fittest. If you come in my way and you're smaller than me, you have to go. Because the human race was made for more than that. You know what else is crystal clear? This is the generation that's going to end it.
House of Jacinta and Francisco. They are the youngest of nine children that the couple, Manuel Marto, the father, and Olympia Jesus, the mother, had. Francisco was born on June 11, 1908. Jacinta was born on March 5, 1910. Also in this house, Blessed Francisco died on April 4, 1919. Their family lives was very important, especially to the education in faith, in order to grow in faith and in knowledge, to be able to understand what was going to succeed in 1916 and 1917.
Is just being like more grateful for the life that I have. Like, I've been very blessed. I remember after an event in LA, a lot of the kids like didn't have their dads, and I also got a text message. One of my close friends' dad had just passed away suddenly from a heart attack. And like, my dad, I'm very close with him. He always tells me he's proud of me. He always tells me he loves me. And that after that event, I called my dad and I said, "Dad, like, just thank you so much for your support and always saying you're proud of me. There's dads out there that will never say that to their kids." And I don't know, I just kind of poured my heart out to my dad, and it touched him so much. He went to his fourth day group, shared the voicemail with his friends, and all his friends were like, "Oh my gosh," they were like crying over this and saying, "Wow, that a daughter would say this to her dad, that's so beautiful." But I think the biggest change, yeah, is just being able to go up to my family, tell them I love them, and how that has changed my family. Because in my family, we didn't really ever say, like, "I love you" that much. Like, on the phone, we never, some people would be like, "Oh, bye, I love you." We didn't really do that. And I just started doing that hard as nails. And I think it's really helped my, it's, you know, opened my family up to be okay with showing, I guess, affection to each other. I grew up with five older brothers. Like, you know, they're not very affectionate people. But they, like, write me letters now and just tell me how proud they are of me and how happy that I'm here. And yeah, just being like, when I came back from break and I sat down with my brother Patrick and we were talking about discernment and just like being able to have a conversation with my brothers about what I'm doing here at Hard as Nails and just tell them how much I love them. And they reciprocate that. They say, "Elisa, I love you." And they hug me goodbye. And like the last night before I came back here from break, my dad sits down next to me and goes, "Elisa, I'm really gonna miss you." And he like started crying. I was like, "Dad, I'm gonna miss you too." And Just like the fact that before he probably wouldn't have said it like that. He would have said, oh, goodbye, I love you. But he wouldn't have come up to me and been like, I'm really gonna miss you. Like, I love you so much.
And welcome to this edition of The Crux of the Matter. I'm Father Wade Menezes of the Fathers of Mercy. Today I'd like to talk briefly about the benefits to be gained from a worthily received, frequent, and devout confession. Although it is true that the Church's canon law requires confession of our sins at least once a year, this is also one of the precepts of the Church, just as noble is the Church's time-honored tradition of confessing one's sins at least once a month. Whether confessing mortal or venial sins, the benefits to be gained from a frequent confession are many. For example, apart from the obvious effect of being forgiven of one's sins, frequent confession brings with it a purification of conscience. In the soul, grace is increased. The will is strengthened. Self-knowledge is increased. More rapid growth in virtue takes place. Humility grows. Bad habits are assisted in being overcome. A spirit of mediocrity is assisted in being overcome, and greater self-control is achieved in one's daily life. Indeed, friends, frequent confession helps us to advance in the spiritual life and to be more faithful to our daily duty, regardless of what one's vocation might be, whether single, married, or a consecrated bishop, priest, deacon, or vowed religious. Remember, just as unchecked everyday faults and weaknesses can lead one to commit venial sin, so can unchecked venial sin lead one into mortal sin. St. Augustine, the great doctor of the Church, sums up this truth when he states, "While he is in the flesh, a man cannot help at least having some light sins. But if you call them light when you weigh them, tremble then when you count them. For a number of light objects makes a great heavy mass. A number of drops fill a river, and a number of grains makes a heap. What then is our hope? Above all, confession." This is the crux of the matter. God bless you, and thanks for joining us.